Good evening, and thank you for joining us this evening. The Third and Fourth Angels' messages would like to present the movement of a few good men that began the pioneers from 1840 to 1843. Before we begin, we would like to ask us to have a word of prayer. For those that are able, let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we bow before you, in the name of Jesus Christ, bless us this evening and bless the hearers in these studies that we may grow in you, is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. The movement that began with a few men were a few pioneers. It was not 20 pioneers or 40 pioneers that began the movement. Of course, the movement began in 1840 to 1843. Studies of the doctrines also consist of various elaboration of many, many topics. But this evening, we'd like to begin with the movement of the pioneers that begin our studies. The pioneers began in 1840-1843. Elder Palmer, Joshua V. Himes, James White, Joseph Bates, Cumberland, Gurney, Hiram Edson, and of course Ellen Gold White, who was actually the young lady that received the gift of prophecy. She was among the men that were around the round table, and when they would study, she would go into vision to confirm that the doctrines were correct. These pioneers began in the year of 1842. They were first called conferences. Therefore, the prophet and messenger, Sister Ellen G. White, began her first vision in the year of 1846. Your reference is in Life Sketches 248. When the year of 1843 entirely passed away, unmarked by the advent of Jesus, those who had looked in faith for his appearing were for a time left in doubt and perplexity. But notwithstanding their disappointment, many continued to search the scriptures, examining anew the evidences of their faith and carefully studying the prophecies to obtain further light. The Bible testimony in support of their position seemed clear and conclusive. Your reference is in the Great Controversy 1884 edition, page 241. And of course, I'd like to read to us our scriptural text in these last days in Revelation chapter 10, verse 11. And he said unto me, thou must prophesy again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings. This prophecy is to be fulfilled in our time, ladies and gentlemen. We are actually the last generation. And now it is time for us to take notes in regards to what was given to the last generation, which will form 144,000. Plus, we will have a humongous great multitude. This evening, we'd like to ask you to take your notes, take your studies, encourage your pastors, study with them, study with your laymen, your elders, your deacons, those in various denominations, study. This message is intended for all denominations. In continuing, signs which could not be mistaken pointed to the coming of Christ as near. The believers could not explain their disappointment, yet they felt assured that God had led them in their past experience. Their faith was greatly strengthened by the direct and forcible application of those scriptures which set forth a tarrying time. Great Controversy, 1884, page 241. Continuing, as early as 1842, the Spirit of God had moved upon Charles Fitch to devise the prophetic chart, the 1850 chart and the 1843 and 1844 chart. These charts are correct, but the Seventh-day Adventist Church has put them under the table so that you and I in the world would have no idea of what is taking place. Let me continue. Which was generally regarded by Adventists as a fulfillment of the command given by the prophet Habakkuk in chapter 2. To write the vision and make it plain upon tables, no one, however, then saw the tarrying time, which was brought to view in the same prophecy, Great Controversy, 1884 edition, page 241. So I saw that those who had no experience in the first, second, angel's messenger, must receive them from those who had an experience and followed down through the messages. Well, I wasn't there in the 1800s, in 1842. I wasn't with the gentlemen that were around the table studying with Ellen G. White, who had been called at a young age to partake of the information and to give it to the world. I wasn't there. I must go back to the original books that you see before me, which is actually Testimonies numbers 1 through 30, Spirit of Prophecy volumes 1 through 4, and also other books that are here. And I won't go into them, because what I want to do here is encourage you to obtain the original books. Obtain the original Review and Herald articles, which are 6 volumes to my right, that we will be discussing in this study. In continuing, as Jesus was crucified, so I saw that these messages have been crucified as well within the Seventh-day Adventist Church and among the people. Reference is Great Controversy, 1858 edition, page 75. As the disciples declared that there was salvation in no other name under heaven given among men, so also should the servants of God faithfully and fearlessly declare that those who embrace but a part of the truth connected with the third message must gladly embrace the first, second, and third messages as God had given them, or have no lot nor part in the matter. In other words, you don't have a right to be preaching the message because you don't understand the message. You never had an opportunity. So now you must go to the books and study the message. And the Holy Spirit is there to lead us in righteousness and in truth and to correct us in all that we're doing. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Your reference is in Great Controversy, 1858, page 75. In continuing, he told them that he would send them the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, to guide, bless, and lead them into all truth. And he lifted up his hands and blessed them. As the ministration of Jesus closed in the holy place, he passed into the holiest and stood before the ark containing the law of God. He sent another mighty angel to earth with the third message to empower the messages they were given prior to the event of the first and second angels' messages. He placed a parchment in the angel's hand, and as he is descended to earth in majesty and power, he proclaimed a fearful warning, the most terrible threatening ever born to man. Great Controversy, 1858, page 162. This message was designed to put the children of God upon their guard and show them the hour of temptation and anguish that was before them. Said the angel, they will be brought into close combat in these last days in 2017, it's coming, with the beast and his image. The Vatican Church is the beast in Bible prophecy, which is focusing on serving on a Sunday, which is a national Sunday law that Congress is preparing to pass as I speak. Protestantism has risen to the top and it's falling. Now they want to return back to moral issues. And how they will do that is by persuading you and me to go to church on the first day of the week, Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, and enforcing those false premises and worshiping a spurious Sabbath. Now, the image is worship, mandatory worship. So our Constitution will be repudiated to its core. It won't exist anymore. Continuing, their only hope of eternal life is to remain steadfast. Yes, steadfast and grounded in the original message that was given to us, not books of a new order. Although their lives are at stake, yet they must hold fast the truth. The third angel closes his message with these words, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of Elohim and have the testimony of Yeshua HaMashiach. Your reference for that is in the Great Controversy, 1858 edition, page 163. And he repeated these words. He pointed to the heavenly sanctuary. The minds of all who embrace this message are directed to the most holy place where Jesus stands before the ark, present tense today, making his final intercession for all those for whom mercy still lingers and for those who have ignorantly broken the law of God. Stay with me. I'm going to give you a blessing. This atonement is made for one, righteous dead, as well as for the number two, righteous living. Can I hear an amen? Jesus makes an atonement for those who died not receiving the light upon God's commandments, who sinned ignorantly. Can I hear an amen? This is his love and his mercy. Jesus loves us. Jesus is looking to save us from our ignorance, our transgressions. After Jesus opened the door of the Most Holy, the light of the Sabbath was seen, and the people of God were to be tested and proved. This is what's taking place now. As God proved the children of Israel anciently to see if they would keep his law, he's doing that today now. It's not going to end until it's over. I saw the third angel pointing upward, showing disappointment ones, showing the disappointed ones the way to the holiest of the heavenly sanctuary. They followed Jesus by faith into the what? Into the Most Holy. Reference, Great Controversy, 1858, page 163. The churches would not receive the light of the first angel's messages, ladies and gentlemen. And as they rejected the light from heaven, they fell from the favor of God, mercy. This includes the nominal Protestant churches around the world. They rejected these messages as the nominal Seventh-day Adventist churches rejected the messages way back in the year of 1892. All Protestant churches in the world rejected the messages, including the 2520 that you find in Leviticus chapter 25. They trusted in their own strength and placed themselves by their opposition to the first message in Revelation 14 verses 6 through 7, where they could not see the light of the second angel's message in Revelation chapter 14 verse 8. But the beloved of God who were oppressed answered to the message, Babylon is fallen, and left the fallen churches, Revelation 14 verse 8. Your reference in the Great Controversy, 1858, page 140. The midnight cry was given to give power to the second angel's message. So you have the midnight cry being given first, ladies and gentlemen, that's to empower the second angel's message in its power. But it has not fully completely fallen, the Vatican Church and the nominal Seventh-day Adventist churches, nominal Christian churches. Don't get offended. I didn't say this. Jesus said it. He said it to the prophet Ellen G. White. She's not a plagiarist. The reason why she's called a plagiarist, it is because those who had inserted preconceived ideas rounded the messages out and gave them to you in Testimonies for the Church, volume 1 through 9, and Conflict of the Ages, 1 through 5. And we will discuss this in the study so that you yourselves will be grounded and knowing the message. Let us go on. The midnight cry was given to give power to the second angel's message. The third angel's message was lighted up past, present, and future. And they know that God has indeed led them by his mysterious providence. It was presented to me, Ellen G. White, that the remnant that's going to go through, not the Seventh-day Adventist Church, not the nominal Christian churches or the nominal Adventist churches, the Advent are part of the remnant that go through. Follow Jesus into the most holy place where he's at now, present tense, interceded in our behalf, and beheld the ark and the mercy seat and were captivated with the glory. Many who embraced the third message had not an experience in the two former messages, referring to the first message in Revelation 14, 6 through 7, and the second angel's message in references to verse 8. Let me continue. Satan understood this, ladies and gentlemen, from the beginning of time to the end. He knows this. And his evil eye was upon them to overthrow them, but the third angel was pointing them to the most holy place. Where was he pointing them? Into the most holy place, the second apartment where Christ is at. The holy place is closed. So when we baptize you, we don't baptize you into a nominal Adventist church or nominal Christian church. We baptize you into the remnant in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Why? It is because it is in the sanctuary that your salvation is at, because Christ is there, the Father's there. They're interceding and praying for us. Jesus Christ is mediating on our behalf. And those who had and experience in the past messages were pointing them, in other words, the people were pointing them to this heavenly sanctuary in heaven. Can I hear an amen? Those who rejected the messages, the first message, could not be benefited by the second message and were not benefited by the midnight cry, which was to prepare them to enter with Jesus by faith into the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. And by rejecting the two former messages, they can see no light in the third angel's message, which shows the way into the most holy place. I saw that the nominal churches and the Jews crucified Jesus Christ afresh, Yeshua HaMashiach, had crucified these messages, and therefore they have no knowledge of the move made in heaven or of the way into the most holy, and they cannot be benefited by the intercession of Jesus there. How sad. How sad that society and leadership can turn around and pervert the message. Do you and I expect to see him in the kingdom? Have you read in the writings that they have repented? And are those their writings? Or is it somebody else's writings that have crossed their ideas? In doing this, they placed themselves where they could not receive the blessing on the day of Pentecost or Feast of Weeks, referring to the early rain, because at the early rain, the disciples and all 120 of them that ascended to heaven had received the baptism of the Holy Spirit to empower them to give this message. Can I hear an amen? Great Controversy, 1858, page 170. Here is a letter from Sister Harmon in Falmouth, Massachusetts, February 15, 1846. Focus on the date. God showed me the following 1 year ago this month. I saw a throne, and on it sat the Father and His Son, Jesus Christ. I gazed on Jesus' conscience and admired His lovely person. The Father's person I could not behold, for a cloud of glorious light covered Him. I asked Jesus if His Father had a form like His, like Himself. He said He had, but I could not behold it, for, said He, if you should for once see the glory of His person, you would cease to exist. Reference is found in Articles from the Day Star, page 58 and 59. Therefore, before the throne was, one, the Advent people. So many people in the Seventh-day Adventist churches and the nominal Christian churches have been saying there's only two groups, the wicked and the righteous. Well, we got news for each other here. Let's read what the scriptures say that Christ gave to Ellen White. One, the Advent people. She saw the Advent people, not Seventh-day Adventist, Advent people. Excuse me. Two, the church. And number three, what is it? The world. Excuse me. I saw a company bow before the throne. This is key. Focus. Deeply interested, while most of them stood up disinterested and careless, those who were bowed before the throne would offer up their prayers and look to Jesus. Then He would look to His Father and appear to be pleading with Him. Then a light came from the Father to His Son and from Him to the praying company that were praying in the holy place. Your reference is Articles from the Day Star, page 59. I saw an exceeding bright light come from the Father to the Son, and from the Son it waved over the people before the throne. But few would receive this great light, and many out of from under it, and many came out from under it and immediately resisted it. Others were careless and did not cherish the light, and it moved all from them. Some cherished it and went and bowed down before the throne with the little praying company. This company all received the light and replaced it, excuse me, and rejoiced it, and rejoiced in it as their consciences shone with its glory. Ladies and gentlemen, if I can share this with us, I'd like to share with us. They were down of the Daniel chapter 2, the bronze, the silver, which is Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, paganism Rome, down to papal Rome. We're down to the 10 toes. And if you cannot see the prophecies, it's because you're not studying. You don't care. You want to listen to a pastor that's not feeding you because he hasn't received the baptism of the Holy Spirit when he should be focusing on that and teaching you how to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We're down here, ladies and gentlemen. I don't mind what faith you're in if you're not in faith, but we're down here. Peace and safety is coming. Let me go on. However, then I saw the Father rise from the throne and in a flaming chariot go into the Holy of Holies within the veil and did sit. Then I saw thrones which I had not seen before. Then Jesus rose up from the throne and most of those who were bowed down rose up with him. Stay with me on this point. And I did not see one ray of light pass from Jesus to the careless multitude after he rose up. And they were left in perfect, what? Darkness. This is our problem. No one knows where Jesus is at in the holy place or in the most holy of place or in the outer court or in the sanctuary. For that matter, no one knows where he's at in the sanctuary. Do you know where he's at in the sanctuary? Those who rose up when Jesus did kept their eyes fixed on him as he left the throne and led them out a little way. Then he raised his right arm and he heard his lovely voice saying, "Wait ye, I am going to my Father to receive the kingdom." Then I beheld Jesus as he was before the Father, a great high priest. And on the hem of his garment was a bell and a pomegranate, a bell and a pomegranate. Then Jesus showed me the difference between faith and feeling. And I saw those who rose up with Jesus send up their faith to Jesus in the holiest and praying, "Father, give us thy spirit." Then Jesus would breathe on them the Holy Ghost. That's what Jesus did. Then Jesus would breathe upon them the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. The Paraclete is one and the same. It's the Spirit that comes from him that came from the Father. In the breath was light, power, and much agape love, joy, and peace. Then I turned to look at the company who were still bowed before the throne. They did not know that Jesus had left it. Satan, however, appeared to them to be by the throne trying to carry on the work of God. I saw them look up to the throne and pray, "My Father, give us thy spirit." Then Satan would breathe on them an unholy influence. In it there was light and much power, but no sweet agape love, joy, and peace. Our Father is love. Yeshua is love. Satan's objective was to keep them deceived and to draw back and deceive God's children. I saw one after another leave the company who were praying to Jesus in the holiest, go and join those before the throne. And they at once received the unholy influence of Satan. Articles from the Day Star, page 59. This is what's happened. In Isaiah chapter 14, verse 16, "They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble, that did shake kingdoms?" Verse 17, "That made the world as a wilderness and destroyed the cities thereof, that opened not the house of his prisoners?" Lucifer, Satan, Hasatan, that's who he's referring to, introduced rebellion in heaven. All sin will return back to him. God desired that a change take place. Can I hear an amen? God desired that. And that the work of Satan be brought out in its genuine aspect, so that the whole world from the beginning of time to the end would see this evil being who deceived his Torah, his law, who rejected his government, so that everybody could do whatever they please and go whoring around, murdering, causing wars, causing frustrations, allowing bills to be passed of sodomy, just like Sodom and Gomorrah. However, in those days, ladies and gentlemen, they practiced sodomy. They practiced all this filth. And today, how dare us in this country of the United States and around the world have the audacity to pass laws to let the people practice sodomy, homosexuality. That is an abomination. Don't ever expect them to be in the kingdom. So I implore you, you who are watching this, if you're practicing this, Jesus condemns the sin, not you. It's the sin that he's asking you to get rid of. He loves you with an overwhelming love. Jesus has invited you to come unto him, and you are not obeying Christ, ladies and gentlemen. When you go to human sources for support and consolation, is not this the reason that the people of God are destitute of the fruits of the Holy Spirit? Is not this the reason why their religion experience is of so dwarfed a character? Satan exalts as he sees men looking to men and trusting in men to be wisdom for them. Mercy, don't do that. The soul that looks to men as to God is left exposed to the temptations and assaults of the enemy. And the evil one sees it, that human defects shall mar the work of God. Review and Herald, Volume 3. So in Review and Herald, Volume 3, I have it here for you. It's right here. Here's Review and Herald. All you got to do is pull it out of your shelf and read that whole book, and you will understand and accept the blessings that have been given to us. Jesus, Yeshua, loves his people. Can I hear an amen? He loves you. Before his crucifixion, he said to his followers, I call you not servants, but I have called you friends. That's a blessing. After his resurrection, he tenderly drew them to himself and imparted to them divine instruction. And here it comes. He said, ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. In Fredericksburg, Virginia, in California, in Fresno, California, Los Angeles, California, New York City, Australia, Africa, Russia, Cuba, Iran, Indonesia, you shall be witnesses of me. Why? Because you have a relationship with him. You have received the baptism of the Holy Spirit to empower your preaching. Review and Herald, Volume 3, page 175 and 176. To make matters worse, the Trinitarian people around the world, like Catholics, all of them, poor people, they don't know, right? They worship not three gods, they worship four gods, the Virgin Mary. The Trinitarian doctrine comes from Rome. That's who taught the whole world of Trinitarianism. Therefore, in the transition prior to 1980, Ted Wilson, the president of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, they themselves, after their meetings and discussions, allowed the Trinitarian doctrine to come in, which is the doctrine of the Holy Spirit. This is where all this trash comes from. Read your Bibles, ladies and gentlemen. If you understood your Bibles, you wouldn't need the spirit of prophecy. You wouldn't need testimonies for the church. You wouldn't need articles to read. Had you been faithful in understanding what the Bible says, you'd be faithful. You wouldn't be in the dilemma that we're in now. Therefore, once again, to make matters worse, the Trinitarian then believes in God, the Spirit, a third divine co-eternal person. This leaves us with three individual God beings. This is a polytheistic religion, another gospel. So in Galatians chapter 1, 6-7, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him, Jesus Christ, that call you into the grace, that he's called you into his grace, or how may I say it, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you all over the world and would pervert the gospel of Christ. This is what's happened. The term, the third person of the Godhead, refers to the glorified life of Christ. It is not a separate, co-eternal person. It is himself divested from the personality of humanity. 14, manuscript release, page 23, paragraph 3. Now, I'm going to read it again slowly. The term, the third person of the Godhead, refers to the glorified life of Christ. It is not a separate, co-eternal person. It is himself, Yeshua, or Jesus in the Western culture that you've grown up to know, by name. Divested means power. So when you read, it is Yeshua himself in power from the personality of humanity. It's not a separate being, ladies and gentlemen. Note, it is the manifestation of the Father working through his Son. Jesus Christ, before coming as a baby, found in the trough to the shepherds, which was the sign to them, had discussed with the Father and was willing to give up omnipresence. Christ gave up omnipresence. And of course, at one time, the Father and Jesus Christ had omnipotence, omniscience, and omnipresence. But on this condition, because it was so important, he was willing to give up omnipresence, and in 31 AD went to heaven, and the Father blew upon Christ his spirit. Christ received the Holy Spirit and sent it to the world to be with every individual at the same time. Christ tells us that the Holy Spirit is the Comforter, and the Comforter is the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of truth, which the Father shall send in my name. This refers to the omnipresent of the Spirit of Christ called the Comforter. Your reference is in 14, manuscript release, page 179, paragraph 2. Yeshua gave up omnipresent and only has omnipotent and omniscient. It is the Paraclete, the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Spirit that are one and the same Spirit. It comes from the Father. In order fully to carry out this plan, it was decided that Christ, the only begotten Son of God, should give himself an offering for sin, ch. page 223. In Galatians 1, verse 8, but though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. This is what's being said here. This is being said to the Galatians. This is where a lot of things began. And continuing, as we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you, then that ye have received, let him be accursed. It says it twice. Continuing, cumbered with humanity, Christ could not be in every place personally, therefore, it was altogether for their advantage that he should leave them, go to his Father, and send the Holy Spirit to be his successor on earth. The Holy Spirit is himself, Yeshua, Jesus, divested of the personality of humanity and independent thereof. Independent means not depending on another's authority. He would represent himself, Jesus Christ, as present in all places by his Holy Spirit, as the omnipresent. John chapter 17, verse 7. Your reference is manuscript release, volume 14, page 23, paragraph 3, in the year of 1898. However, 3 years later, something happened. What happened here was a comparing of changes that took place. In other words, the men and women were not happy with what had occurred. And what they did, they got the original writings and began to prepare a book. Until later on, after a few years, then they would name it the Czar of Ages. Let me continue. The Holy Spirit is Christ's representative, but divested of the personality of humanity and independent thereof. In other words, This whole phrase that's up here on top is added information that the people that were filled with preconceived ideas inserted and took out the original writings. And continuing, cumbered with humanity, Christ could not be in every place personally. Therefore, it was for their interest, and it ends here, change the whole sentence beginning here. And it continues, and I will show you in a few the correct reading. That he should go to the Father and send the Spirit to be his successor on earth. By the Spirit, the Savior would be accessible to all. Okay. In this sense, he would be nearer to them than if he had not ascended on high. Your reference is from Desire of Ages, page 669, paragraph 2. That Desire of Ages was written in the year 1889. Continuing. Now, this little synopsis here is in regards to the men and women who changed the writings and elected in the committee. Butler, who was the president of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, appointed the committee as follows. One, it was G.I. Butler, who was a Seventh-day Adventist, Willie C. White, who was the manager and the editor of the books, who was Alan G. White's son. They were very close. Uriah Smith was another scoundrel that turned around and rewrote the Great Controversy. J.H. Wagner, Sr., S.N. Haskell, all of these five men were officials that were selected in the committee to change the testimonies for the church, all 30 numbers, and Spirit of Prophecy, all 40 books. Now you have testimonies, volumes 1 through 9, which are corrupt. Spirit of Prophecy, they rewrote them into Conflict of the Ages, which are corrupt to the core. In reading, that this body appoint a committee of five to take charge of the republication of these volumes, which is these right here, according to the above preambles and resolutions. For your reference, it's Review and Herald, November 27th, 1883. At the 1883 General Conference session, the main issue that was discussed here by all the officials all over the world was the Spirit of Prophecy books and testimonies for the church. This was the issue because Alan White told them, the Lord has not authorized me to rewrite my books because a prophet never backtracks and rewrites. The prophet always goes forward, never back. That is a hermeneutic principle. In continuing, therefore, this is the original manuscript. John 17, verse 7, manuscript release, volume 14, page 23, paragraph 3, in the year of 1895, which is when it was written. The correct writings, the incorrect writings are in the Desire of Ages. Incorrect writings. The Desire of Ages, page 669, paragraph 2. The book was completed in the year 1898. Was written from the book entitled The Life of Our Lord by Samuel J. Andrews, who was a Sunday keeper. Now, from the year 1898, 32 years difference, brings us to the year 1866. Now, from 1866, 30 years difference, brings us to 1898, when the book was finally voted to be named Desire of Ages. Okay? Now, they got the information from the book entitled The Life of Our Lord, written by Samuel J. Andrews, who was a Sunday keeper. Let me continue. Alan G. White, in Volume 3, The Lonely Years of 1876 and 1891, was actually written by Arthur L. White, her nephew, who was writing correctly. And it's on page 385 as I read. In the absence of direct instruction from Alan White, our clues in the materials themselves, Mrs. Davis consulted carefully prepared harmonies of the Gospels, and as the work progressed, made considerable use of Samuel J. Andrews' Life of Our Lord upon the Earth, which as noted on the title page, took into account historical, chronological, geographical relations. As the work was thought to be nearing completion in 1896, Marion, which is Marion Davis, worked on the three general introductory chapters in the book, Desire of Ages, that we have now. She got those three chapters out of Our Lord Upon the Earth. The first chapter is God with us. Those are Samuel J. Andrews' writings. The chosen people. The fullness of time. And what they did is they took the book, they read it, and as they wrote it, then they rewrote it into these three chapters. In Desire of Ages, in the first three chapters, thereafter, you have a compilation of his writings. And then, of course, then you have the full text of Review and Herald Articles, volumes 1-6. Okay? And continuing, sought the counsel of Herbert Lacey of the Avondale School on the arrangement of paragraphs. He was a rather youthful graduate of the classical course offered at Battle Creek College. He made some helpful suggestions in the matter of the sequence of the thoughts presented. Marion Davis had gone to school. She went to college to learn the Gospels. Okay, she was Alan G. White's elite secretary. In other words, she was more trustworthy. She traveled with her all over. While they were in Australia, this is where the work was being done. So we want the correct references for this information, where it all came from. Listen, I didn't write it. I'm an evangelist, evangelizing you again, preparing you to give the message and preparing you for the second coming so you can prepare your family at home, so you can prepare the people in prison, in hospitals, all over the world, whatever businesses they're in. Even Donald Trump, who received the great controversy for the day of inauguration, he received it by the grace of our Savior, Jesus Christ. But let us go on here. Here is the correct reading. Cumbered with humanity, Christ could not be in every place personally. Therefore, it was altogether for their advantage that he should leave them, go to his Father, and send the Holy Spirit to be his successor on earth. So the Father gave him the Holy Spirit. It wasn't Christ that was authorized to have the Holy Spirit. It was the Father who gave it to him. The Holy Spirit is himself, Jesus Christ, divested of the personality of humanity and dependent thereof, ladies and gentlemen. He would represent himself as present in all places by his Holy Spirit as the omnipresent, because he surrendered omnipresent so that the Spirit could come from the Father to him, to the world, to be in fallen sinners, us. Us, ladies and gentlemen, John 17, verse 7. Manuscript release, volume 14, page 23, paragraph 3, 1895. This is the correct manuscript. But they rewrote it in Desire of Ages. The Holy Spirit, the Lord's throne, is in heaven, ladies and gentlemen. Can I hear an amen? It's in heaven. Yet by his Spirit, he is everywhere present, omnipresent. Your reference, Education, page 132, in the year of 1903. The book Education is a compilation of the writings of Alan White. The Spirit of Prophecy books, 1, 2, 3, 4, the last one was printed in 1884. Testimonies numbers 1 through 30, the last one was printed in the year 1881. Education, it was printed in 1903. The compilation of this book is the work of Marion Davis and the committee and others. Let me go on. Objection, the third person of the Godhead, the Trinitarian, objects. I'm not Trinitarian. That is a Catholic term, and everybody's believing in the Father, Holy Spirit, saying they're all God each. They all got their own throne. That's a big white lie. It is an abomination. The Father has a throne. Yeshua has a throne. There's no throne up there for the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit comes from the Father. Can I hear an amen? The term, the third person of the Godhead, presents the Holy Spirit as a third co-eternal person. However, inspiration answers the truth. The term third person of the Godhead refers to the glorified life of Christ. It is not a separate co-eternal person. Glory, hallelujah. The truth is coming down. Listen, it is himself, Jesus Christ, divested in the power from the personality of humanity, ladies and gentlemen. What they have done is that they revealed the Father, they revealed Jesus Christ, they reveal the Holy Spirit. This is the ministration of the Father in the sanctuary. Evil had been accumulating for centuries and could only be restrained and resisted by the mighty power of the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Godhead, who would come with no modified energy, but in the fullness of divine power, another spirit must be met, the evil spirit of Hasatan, the devil. For the essence of evil was working in all ways, and the submission of man to this satanic captivity was amazing. Your reference is found right here. Special Testimonies for Ministers and Workers, number 7. Ain't that beautiful? Ain't that beautiful? The prince of the power of evil can only be held in check by the power of God in the third person of the Godhead, the Holy Spirit. Ladies and gentlemen, this covenant that has been made from the beginning is the restoration of the Spirit, is the covenant of grace. As I stand here to share with you what has happened, Richard Gonzales only shares the experience of the early reign of the baptism of the Holy Spirit that I've experienced. I can only elaborate and preach and teach only what I've experienced, not what you've experienced. This Bible is holy and true. And no matter that it's been having so many problems with all these vernacular Bibles, I can share with you without a doubt that any Bible can get us to the kingdom. But when they come here and they mess with what the pen of inspiration wrote, and you want to rewrite it and put in there your own preconceived ideas, let me share with you that in Revelation chapter 22, 18 and 19, you don't add and you don't subtract. These men, from then until now in 2017, and just like they rewrote the Great Hope and took everything out, I don't expect to see them in the kingdom. But if they repent of what they have done, that's a whole different story. All judgment is given to our Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. But then he's given it to the holy saints who are resurrected. Judgment's going on, ladies and gentlemen. And all that you've seen is all truth. So you need to receive the early reign of the Holy Spirit. You need to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Not so when you're perfect do you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Ladies and gentlemen, you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit to help you to reach perfection. Can I hear an amen? This is the purpose of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That you and I may live in love, get along with each other. Destruction's coming. A national Sunday law is coming. But you and me have to comprehend the three angels' messages. We weren't with those pioneers back then. There was only 7. Not all the rest of them were pioneers. Stay with your Bible. If you don't want to read the Spirit of Prophecy, Testimonies for the Church, let me share something with you. Then read the Bible. Read the Bible. Study it. And ask Jesus Christ to bless you with His Spirit, to regenerate your spirit, so that you may be a living soul, so that He can bless you and guide you. Therefore, it is important in these last days that we must prophesy again. Revelation chapter 10, verse 11. To peoples, different languages, kings and nations. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, everything is going to start winding up. And you and I have to have a place. Start getting out of the cities. Start getting out of these towns. Find a secluded place up in the mountains. Make sure it has a well. Make sure you know how to plant your seeds. Make sure they're organically grown and not hybrid seeds. Ladies and gentlemen, the covenant that Christ has made with us is still valid. The restoration of the Spirit is the covenant of grace. Our Father who art in heaven, it is our prayer this evening that you may be exalted, Jesus, Yeshua, and that we ourselves may accept your messages by reading and listening to the small, still voice speaking to every listener, those who are present, that you're coming and that the time of trouble is coming. Heavenly Father, we ask for your grace and your mercy on all that has been said and done. Forgive those who had gone before us and began to teach Trinitarianism. Heavenly Father, correct us of our ways to your Son, Jesus Christ, and bless us afresh with your Holy Spirit, is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.